Hello, Phil here from Wings of Pegasus, and welcome to another analysis video. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe. On the agenda tonight, we're going back to 1976. We're going to be taking a look at Elvin Bishop, and he's going to be performing Fooled Around and Fell in Love. So let's get Elvin and the guys up on screen and see how they get on. I'm just going to jump in here because I need to clear up that Elvin is playing guitar here. We're just about to get into a solo, but we've got Mickey Thomas on lead vocal here, and what a lead vocal he supplies. This whole performance, he is pitch perfect, and I mean that in the sense of being so accurate. Obviously not exactly on the note, but that's the point because you get the expression. We're not talking about auto-tune here. Just fantastic phrasing, control of vibrato. We've got chest voice, head voice, also falsetto that's going to be coming in later, and I will point that out when we get there. But there's this total control that he has to his voice that is so impressive. And I think a lot of people might have been confused because on the single cover, it did have a picture of Elvin by a microphone, and it looks like he's singing. He's got his guitar as well, and people that didn't know that Mickey did the vocal might have assumed that Elvin was the singer. But Elvin has said that his voice wouldn't have done this song justice because Elvin wrote the song and then got Mickey to sing it. And by the way, Mickey did start out as a backing vocalist for the band, but then got promoted. Of course, when you listen to his voice, you want that guy at the front of the stage. The other thing you'll notice at 36 seconds into the song, Mickey's just finished his first vocal phrase, and you hear the whistles and applause in the audience because of the appreciation of the quality of vocal that's being laid down. And if you're starting a song and the crowd are already loving the vocal, it's not a bad sign at all. So just let the guy sing for as long as he wants to. But it's the control of vibrato that he has, a really even frequency. And this is where it works so well with the backing harmonies, because they're matching the frequency of their vibrato. And having that makes such a difference, because you don't want somebody with a different expression in their voice with that vibrato behind the lead vocalist, because they will tend to clash and won't blend as well. Whereas we get a great blending of vocals here. And the other thing that Elvin does with that vibrato is just tweak it above the note that he's singing. And he makes it sound so free and easy with his application that you just want to listen to it all night. Such great control. That's what it's all about, being able to hold a note, apply vibrato to the end of that note, and also stylistically, if he wants to, he can end a line with a little throwaway phrase. Such a great bluesy feel to the vocal as well. So we're going to be getting back into the video. As always, the link to this is going to be in the description below, so you guys can go there to check it out the whole way through without me interrupting it. But this is going to be the vocal lead-in to Elvin's solo, and I've stopped it in exactly the right place because at this point, Mickey is going to be singing in his head voice, and then he's going to bring it back down into his chest voice. So you'll be able to hear the difference between those two registers. But let's get back into this. Going to jump in here quickly because we're going to be talking through Elvin's solo, all about melody and feel, expression, it's all in there. While we're looking at Mickey, I just want to mention the change of register that we just had, because it's a great example of head voice and falsetto, the difference between the two, because we've got a pure head voice sound here, and this is at 3 minutes and 35 when it kicks in and Mickey's singing with pure head voice, and then he goes to falsetto at 3 minutes and 38. And you can hear the difference in the tone, but also how Mickey runs out of air because it's falsetto. The chords are not closed, they're not close together, so lots of space for the air to escape. And you'll hear right at the end of that phrase, he's totally out of breath, but with the head voice, because the chords are closed, they're close together, there's no space for the air to escape, he can hold those notes for a lot longer. So I've busted out the guitar again, just quickly to show you what Elvin's doing, but if you do play the guitar yourself, just to give you a little bit of an idea of the shapes, because it's exactly the same shapes that I mentioned a few days ago, with minor pentatonic shapes, major pentatonic shapes, that's exactly what we've got here. So the way that Elvin plays through, and it's a really clean tone here, and I have set it up slightly differently tonight, so hopefully you can still hear my voice, and I'll know in the edit if it's working or not, but you might be able to hear the guitar a little bit more clearly as well. So we're in F, so that's our key, and when we're starting with the lead, actually, it's that kind of feel. I'm not going to play through the whole solo. The thing to look out for is the expression in the vibrato, the frequency of it as well, because when Elvin gets into his bend, that vibrato at the top of the bend is quite fast and totally different to an expression with a slower vibrato. You can hear the difference between those two, and this will be a video that would go on for years if we start analysing the frequency of vibrato and the change of expression you get with each kind, however you change it up. This is how every player gets to sound different, because they've each got their own voice on the guitar using their own vibrato. So Elvin's quite fast here. It also brings up another point about when we start the solo. You can see that Elvin's hand is moving quite a lot when we have. There's quite a lot of hand movement, and you'll see that quite a lot without necessarily hearing a great deal of change in the note or vibrato on the note. You do have the classical side-to-side vibrato, which is very subtle and something that I've mentioned before about fretting a note and then just moving your hand up and down, left and right, but not changing the pitch of the string by bending. When you're playing a rock blues vibrato, you can hear that I'm changing the pitch, so it's going to be more dramatic. And that also brings me on to when you watch somebody playing and they're shaking the whole guitar. Again, if the pitch of the note you're holding down isn't changing, you're not going to get a dramatic effect of vibrato. As soon as you start bending it, then you'll hear that vibrato kick in, and it's not going to be subtle, but that might be what you're after, especially in the blues. A lot of blues players, hence why it's called rock blues vibrato, employ this technique of bending the string in order to get that expression. Just quickly to throw in a guitar hack for any guys that do play, I'm in pentatonic shape one here, which is exactly the same shape across the guitar, whether you're playing in a major key or a minor key. The important thing is when you're playing in the major key, you can hear that I'm ending on the root note of the chord, so it makes sense. If I went and ended there, it's not gonna make sense musically, because I'm not ending on the root note of the chord that I'm playing over the top of. So, in exactly the same way, here's the first hack. The minor pentatonic is always gonna be 3 frets above where you're playing your major shape. So, if I now count up 1, 2, 3, and now you still want to end on that root note, so now the root note is your first finger. And that's a hack, so it means that relationship is going to be the same across the whole guitar neck. And if you're starting in the minor key, if I move down 3 frets to the other position, you get the major version of whatever you're playing. So I do that again. I'm just doing the same thing, give or take one note, but it's sounding happy and then it's sounding sad, because I'm going from major to minor and then minor to major. And this is the kind of thing that you find always mixed up in the blues. You'll have a line that's going, you know, and there's always that blend of major and minor keys, but those shapes are only 3 frets apart, and you only have to learn one shape and just remember to move 3 frets. And hack number 2, when you are playing through the major pentatonic shape 1, end on your first finger as a rule of thumb or finger, because it's just going to resolve itself better and sound nicer. If I'm going, we even have that here with Elvin going, it's always that ending on that first finger. Also, when you're playing in the minor version of the shape, you want to end on your third finger, because that's going to resolve the lines better. It's going to sound more melodic. And like I said, I am generalizing here. It is a hack just for a way to play through the shape and instantly sound better, like you know what you're doing and resolving your lines. But as an example, ending on my third finger here in the minor key sounds great. If I moved it down, and I played the same line there, it doesn't sound like it has ended, and you want to end that sentence. If I went, it's now resolved with the chord that I'm playing over the top of and the root note that I'm ending on. You can get really into details here, but like I said, a hack, just end on your first finger in the major form of the shape, and then when you move up three frets and play in the minor, you then end on your third finger. So with Elvin's playing, it's all about expression. It's not about loads of really fast techniques and trying to fit in as many notes as possible. He's just going with the feel of it. And what you'll find once you start to work on this pentatonic shape one and just getting from the major shape into the minor shape, you'll then find where the shapes overlap. So if you're playing through, and you've got that major version, you can then slide up and straight into. And then you get towards the end there, blending of those scales, and that's where the blues really starts to sound like the blues, because it is that blend of major and minor keys. But we've got a little bit of the performance left to watch, so we'll watch it till the end. And there we have it. As you can see, the video is just about to cut out, so I'm jumping in now. That vocal performance by Mickey Thomas was off the scale because of the control and the pitch across the whole performance. When he does some vibrato at the end of a vocal phrase, he'll throw in a really cool, bluesy, soulful throwaway line that just tails off, that is so accurate pitch-wise as well. If you were to push the tempo, you would lose everything that is in this composition and the whole feel of the song. And Elvin's solo as well on the guitar, he'd have to start speeding up his playing to try and get it within the same bars, because now of course he's going to have a shorter space to fit in all the notes, and the same for the vocal phrases. And this is what people sometimes don't appreciate about a great band, being able to play at tempo of that original recording. This kind of song, it's imperative to do that, to nail the timing, and that is the drummer first of all, but the whole rhythm section just being locked in as they are here. We've also got to put a bit of the spotlight on Elvin in a songwriting capacity, because this is a belter of a song. I always say it's the hardest thing in the music industry and performing. You might be able to master an instrument, but if you can't write a song that's going to connect with people, then you're really going to struggle in the industry to make any money, because people don't have a product that they want to buy from you. Whereas Elvin, with this song, such a strong composition, and I don't think he would have been able to find a better singer than Mickey Thomas to pull this off, because the expression that Mickey's got in his voice is perfect for this. You might know Mickey from Jefferson Starship. I have got a video on here somewhere about Jefferson Airplane, but not Jefferson Starship yet. He was part of the Elvin Bishop band in the mid-70s. We're talking about 75. He did join in 74, but he was a backing singer and then sang lead vocals on Silent Night in 75 and then was the prominent lead singer from then on. 1976, Spend Some Time, and then this in 1976 as well, Fooled Around and Fell in Love. And this got to number three in the charts. It was a monster hit. And by the end of the 70s, is when Mickey then moved to Jefferson Starship. But this is one of those videos that has got talent across the board. You could just analyze Mickey's vocal for about a year and Elvin's guitar playing and focusing on melody and expression and the way that he plays with a really clean tone here as well. Just some classic blues lines, but also piecing it together melodically, because that's what it's all about. And Elvin is so good at doing that. But thank you guys so much for suggesting this video for me to take a look at, and keep those suggestions coming in the comments below. Let me know what you guys think. And if you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe. And I'll see you guys at the next one. Rock!